Money doesn't give us any yield, but on the other end, we attach a lot of value to it. The real origin of money is about two things. The first one is that it makes our life easier, of course. But secondly, and I think that's the real reason, is that because we do not trust each other, unfortunately. And so otherwise we would accept our reciprocal promises, right? So in that sense, we do trust some central entity like a government, a central bank. And this is why money is accepted. Our economy, our modern economy, sophisticated economy, consume a lot of liquidity, needs a lot of liquidity to operate. Money as currency is just one tiny piece of the liquidity securities we used. There are other securities privately issued by banks or credit institutions, and those are really important, and there are similar to money, equivalently used as money, but those are like saving accounts, bank accounts, credit card, debit cards, and between banks, those are also very short loans, interbanking loans, in form of repos, contracts, and so on. When the financial crisis hit the economy and the financial system in the first place, the first reaction is to cut interest rate, but a central bank can do it until a given point when hit the floor, and after that it's hard to implement nominal negative interest rate. So then they have to be creative. So a central bank, according within its mandate, can try many things. The first thing they can try is to lend, but at more attractive conditions, right? For instance, for an extended period, or instead of accepting very safe securities as a collateral security, a central bank can accept riskier securities. And this is actually what the European Central Bank has been doing with the long-term refinancing operation, the famous LTROs. Or instead of lending, a central bank can also buy securities. Those are the quantitative easing operations. Conducting these quantitative easing or unconventional monetary policies in large sense, a central bank inject liquidity into the system, and by doing that, they hope to decrease interest rate, so decrease the cost of capital, and reducing consumption, new consumption. Well, as I told you before, I mean, then when you reach the lower zero bound, so you hit the floor, then they have to do other things, right? They try to do other things. Distorting a security price means that actually then the security price doesn't reflect anymore the fundamental value of the security, so the ability of this security to generate future cash flows. On top of that, a prolonged use of unconventional monetary policies can create some bubbles, asset bubbles, or inflation. So that was the usual criticism addressed to the Bank of Japan, that with the ultra-accommodative monetary policies, they created zombie banks. I don't see why this criticism should not apply to Europe or US. Unconventional monetary policies, when a central bank performs commercial monetary policy, it tries to stimulate the credit channel. But there could be also a perverse incentive scheme, like in Europe, for instance, where the ECB, the European Central Bank, inject a lot of liquidity, but then this money is used, for instance, for what we call it carry trade. A bank prefer to invest in government bonds, provide a higher remuneration and a safer bet rather than lend to households and companies. One of the main problems that created this financial dislocation was that there was a huge concentration in the banking system, right? In the financial intermediation. We haven't solved this problem. It's the other way around. Now these few players are even bigger and the banking system even more concentrated. What we try to do is to increase their capital buffer they have to provide, and try to fix the liquidity mismatch that they have in the balance sheet. If you think about Bear Stearns, a few days before the bankruptcy, they were sitting on I think $60 billion of US dollar cash, but by after 1 week this liquidity evaporated, just because Bear Stearns was relying on very short-term uncollateralized funding means.